And we're now joined by former Senate President Franklin Drilon. Hello, sir. Good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Thank you for having me today.
All right, let's start first with, essentially the feuding houses. What are your thoughts? Should the president intervene?
Firstly, the feuding houses is disappointing. It does not do us any good. You know, when I was Senate President and Sonny Belmonte was the Speaker, we were just a phone call away. And, you know, differences cannot be avoided. There are always two sides of the questions, issues. But never did it happen that we were not able to resolve these differences through a sincere dialogue. We have the mechanisms. We established during the time our time with Sonny Belmonte a small committee where we discussed the differences between our two chambers insofar as the enactment of the law is concerned. You know, interparliamentary courtesy is very important. Otherwise, there will be a clear showing of disunity, and that can only prejudice the performance of government functions. So I would appeal to our former colleagues to start a sincere dialogue between the two of them. And yes, indeed, I have proposed upon queries from ANC that the president should lead the call the leaders of both chamber to a meeting and tell them, look, this is not good for our country, and therefore they should come to an agreement. Only the president can do this because he is our political leader. Nobody else can do it because you talk about the president of the Senate, number three official in our government, the House Speaker number four. So it's logical that only the president can bring them to an understanding. You know, the secret in any conciliation is that you must have a stick. You must have a stick to put the people in line, and you have the carrot to induce them to agree. So only the president has that power and is in a position to do it, given the players in this dispute.
But did the Senate overstep? Because they are investigating the House. So this is how it started. The House saying, you started it. How would you feel if we investigated you?
Let's put it this way. During my time, we never did that. Whenever someone, if ever we invite, and it is with prior informal clearance, and the other side, pwede ka ba rito, pwede ka bang, and a number of congressmen has appeared in the Senate committees on their own volition upon invitation of the Senate, but it was done in a manner that would not ruffle feathers. And, you know, interparliamentary courtesy could not just be pushed aside. Importante po yan. Lahat yan may mandato ng taong bayan, and therefore they can assert that our mandate tells us to do this. And you know, who could question that?
Okay, so I'm curious, do you think the Senate overstepped, that they broke in interparliamentary courtesy?
What have they done? Have they invited or have they subpoenaed? I don't know. I don't know what it was, but certainly, if they invited, there is nothing wrong with that because it is up to the invitee to honor the invitation, and that has been done before. I don't know what happened here, where the members of the House subpoenaed. If they were so, that is improper.
Okay, let's talk about changing the charter. The Senate is now reviewing the economic amendments. What are your thoughts? Are you open? Is it time?
Yes, I am open to revisiting The economic provisions, the restrictive economic provisions.
Which part? Can you be specific, sir?
Well, for example, okay, I'm not prepared to do that at this time.
Go ahead.
You see, I was the principal author of the amendments to the Public Service Act, because, and we did that by limiting the coverage and the meaning of the Public Service Act, by excluding certain industries, mm-hmm. so that the equity and the equity level on those industries, which are removed from the definition of what public services are, we open that to 100% foreign ownership. Clear example: operating an airline. It used to be a definition of public service, part of that definition of public service, and therefore we limited the ownership, or the constitution limited the ownership to 60%. What did we do? We removed the airline. We said you are not part of public service, and therefore we allowed 100% unity. So, you know, yes, there it can be done, but the difficulties that, for example, for all our good intentions to open up a bit our economy within the constitution, you know, somebody brought us to the Supreme Court. Somebody, I don't know.
There are two petitions.
Yeah. And, you know, there are two petitions in the Supreme Court. So, again, this raises the need, really, for us to revisit and provide Congress flexibility insofar as the economic provisions are concerned. I may be wrong, Karen, but I am not aware that there are constitutions which would go into the very detail of economic policies. As Jerry Seacott, Home Secretary Jerry Seacott, a respected economist, testified during the committee hearing in the Senate, you know, these are the economic and social provisions which should not be governed by the Constitution, knowing how difficult it is to amend. You look at our 1935 Constitution. It just sets broad policies. But our Constitution today is very broad and it goes into every detail. And therefore, because of that, we find difficulty adjusting to the realities of today. So I am really in favor of amending the constitution, its economic provisions, because amendments to the constitution is always viewed with mistrust. Every time you propose an amendment to the constitution, they say you want to lengthen the term of the congressman, the president, etc. So I had proposed a bicameral constituent assembly, meaning that the Congress, the both houses, perform their constituent functions of providing amendments to the Constitution, but using the bicameral system, meaning the two houses voting separately. There is nothing in the Constitution which requires that these two houses assemble physically as one body. And they need not. They can pass, and I proposed this in way back 2011, we can pass the amendment using the process allowed by enacting laws, but on a qualified majority, meaning that you can pass the amendment only upon a three-fourths vote of each house voting separately. You know, with all due respect to Justice Mendoza, when he said you have to assemble jointly, no, there is no such provision. It is when the Constitution, in a number of instances, said there must be a joint session. In the case declaring martial law, when Congress acts as a national board of governors, the Constitution says there must be a joint session assembled. In the case Congress passes a resolution declaring the state of war, there must be one assembly.
I was going to say, so you said it, you hit the nail on the head. Any change in the charter is viewed with mistrust.
That's correct. That's correct.
Because this is not the first administration that tried to change the charter.
Looking back at history, there were except Cory and Pinoy. He had proposed amendments.
And also except, I think, a former President Estrada.
Yes. Former President Ramos tried to amend the Constitution. Yes. Former President Erap tried to amend the Constitution.
Even Erap? But Erap didn't stay long enough.
Yeah, no, but he proposed amendments.
All right. Because I know GMA, of course.
Amendments to the Constitution.
Duterte.
Duterte proposed amendments to the Constitution. And now, President Marcos, as I said, only Cory and Pinoy did not propose amendments. And therefore, every time this is proposed, it fails because the mistrust of the people on us politicians. Wala talagang tiwala. Wala kang magawa. Kaya sa akin, but it doesn't mean that we should give up trying to amend our constitution in terms of the economic provision, because as I said, this constitution is so lengthy, is so low that you no longer have flexibility. It's one of the most wordy constitution in the world. I've gone through examining many of these, and talagang in England they don't even have a constitution. So constitution. So, but again, having said that, this is the way we want to run our life, but we must not tie ourselves in the back and, we no longer could move because of the very restrictive provisions insofar as the economy is concerned in our constitution. And has it, this nationalistic provision, has it brought us anywhere? It's a good question to ask. So my view is that we should really open ourselves and adapt to the times by reviewing the restrictive economic provision. And I have done it. I tried to open the economy by passing the Public Service Act.
But that's what I wanted to ask you. I mean, there are several industries that can already be 100% foreign owned, right?
Yes.
You have mining, you have power, and with a public service amendment, and yet we're not seeing as much foreign direct investments as Vietnam. So is it really the constitution, or is it the investment and political climate?
I never said that the constitutional amendment will be all and end all. But you have to admit that when comparisons are made between two jurisdictions, inevitably the first thing that the prospective investor would look is the basic law. And when they see, all of these restrictions, it does not add to the
to the excitement, the encouragement.
Yes, it doesn't add. Yeah, it is not the be all and end all, certainly. Given what we have today, in many areas, we're already playing second fiddle to our neighbors. Yeah. And you add the restrictions that we have in the Constitution, it doesn't make sense.
Okay, my last question is, do you feel, the U.S. Constitution has changed and has been amended several times without this much fanfare, right? Session, the U.S. Constitution.
The U.S. Constitution.
The U.S. Constitution has been amended, I believe, more than 100 times without much fanfare. But do you believe it's also, other than mistrust, the framers of our Constitution also seem to be very attached to the Constitution because they were part of framing it?
I will not attach motive to these people. They really sincerely believe that the Constitution, for various reasons, should not be touched. And there is another thought that we should really amend the constitution. So this is part of the debate. Karen, you know, that is a charge of pride of authorship. Kaya daw ayaw palitan ng ating saligang batas dahil lang sila ang gumawa. Sa akin, I will not delve into that. Just look at it objectively. Do we need to amend the economic provision? Yes. And unfortunately, this need is overtaken by the mistrust of our people on the amendment to the Constitution.
My last question is, should the president already put an end to the people's initiative efforts?
That is not within his power, theoretically. You know, in fact, the a true people's initiative is what it is called, a people's initiative. So it is initiated by the people, by the community. And it is a mode of amending the constitution directly by the people. So, of course, the president is the political leader. If he endorses, then you know it has a great effect. But for him to say tama na, hindi po pwede yan. You know, that's not, we are a system of laws and not of men. And the initiative, people's initiative, is part of our basic law. You cannot prevent the people from doing that as long as it is done properly.
On that note, I want to thank you, as always, for joining me this morning, Senate President Franklin Drilon. Thank you, sir. I hope to see you again.
Thank you, Karen, for having me today, and I hope to see you again in the future, given this very hot debate. Thank you.